Perfecto Desconocido de España. Tony, ¿esta es tu primera película? Cuéntame un poquito sobre El Perfecto Desconocido.
Bueno, pues es una película que me ha llevado 5 años poderla hacer, sobre todo porque es una época muy difícil para hacer cine en España. Y es una historia que cuenta la llegada de un extranjero a un pequeño pueblo de Mallorca, que es una isla de España, y sin proponérselo, él viene en busca de... Viene en busca de respuestas, en busca de... Quiere cerrar una herida del pasado, de algo que ocurrió en ese pueblo, que le ocurrió cuando era joven, pero sin proponérselo, empieza a conocer a una serie de personajes que viven en ese pueblo y que sin querer, él, sin quererlo, les cambia las vidas. Básicamente porque esos personajes buscan a alguien a quien seguir, a alguien a quien poderle contar sus cosas. Y ese personaje es perfecto porque no habla español, no entiende español, con lo cual lo único que sabe hacer es escuchar. Y realmente esa gente lo que necesita es alguien que sepa escuchar. Es un poco... Luego hay más cosas, más... Bueno, así en líneas generales. Es una comedia dramática con un poquito de misterio.
¿El guión también lo has hecho tú?
No. El guión lo he hecho... lo ha escrito un guionista, Arturo Ruiz. Y yo he colaborado en el guión, pero quien lo ha escrito es Arturo, con el que llevo trabajando años desde el mundo del cortometraje.
Cuéntame un poquito sobre tus inicios en el cortometraje. ¿Qué es lo que has hecho? ¿Ha sido documental, ficción?
Sí, sí. Bueno, yo empecé en el cortometraje, me oyes bien, ¿no? En el año 98 ya. He hecho más de 7-8 cortometrajes. Dos de ellos estuvieron nominados a los premios Goya, son los de la Academia de Cine Español, y he ido por muchos festivales, muchos premios, la verdad que me ha ido bastante bien. Y quizás ha sido un poco la escuela para llegar a hacer esta película.
¿Y qué se siente haber terminado tu primer largometraje y bueno, y estar acá en Palm Springs, que es, para el hecho de que estés acá, quiere decir que estás muy bien, realmente, muy bien reconocida?
Ya es un premio estar aquí, ya está, ya estoy satisfecho, ¿no? Es el reconocimiento de un trabajo muy duro, de un trabajo que costaba mucho levantarlo, con gente muy joven. Todos los del equipo éramos primerizos, todos empezábamos, todos veníamos del cortometraje y hemos demostrado que somos capaces de contar historias más largas y que luego esas historias puedan llegar muy lejos, en España, América. Empezamos en octubre en Corea del Sur, en el Festival de Busan, que es muy importante. Luego fuimos a Valladolid, el Festival de España, Valladolid. Es decir, tiene un recorrido modesto, pero muy intenso.
Excelente.
El extranjero de la película es Colm Meaney, es un actor irlandés muy conocido, hace mucho cine americano, mucho cine en Europa. Y está ahí.
¿Cómo? Ahí está. ¿Cómo? Llámalo.
Llámelo.
¿Cómo así te contactaste con Colm? ¿Cómo así decidiste trabajar con él?
Yo tenía una lista de 10 actores y entre ellos estaba Colm. Me dio la casualidad de que Colm vino a vivir a Mallorca, donde yo vivo. Entonces fue muy fácil. Le llamé, quedamos.
Thank you.
Hi. Do you speak Spanish? What was it like interacting with the different actors?
I speak Spanish. No, yeah. No. My Spanish is even worse than my English. It's interesting because I, you know, I've spent a lot of time on the island. I'm working on my Spanish. It's slow. Poco y poco. No, it doesn't speak Spanish. So, see what I had to put up with? This the experience of in the film is very much my experience in New York in real life. I'm just sort of sitting there like the bozo who doesn't understand anything, you know? So, I don't speak Spanish.
Okay.
What part of Mallorca?
This is the north of the island. There is, a lot of mountains, you know, because in Mallorca, when you think, in Mallorca, always people think, you know, the tourism, summer, beach, hotels, you know. But there is other Mallorca, that's the Mallorca that I grew up there, is that kind of village, the little villages into the mountains. It's a great place, but it's nice to visit them. To visit these places during spring or autumn or winter, because there is the winter tourism, people who wants to discover culture, new culture, you know, these beautiful places, you know. And this village is where I grew up, you know. I live there. There is a screenwriter, Arturo, is a friend of mine that we worked together during last years in short films. He started the first draft of the script, and then we start working together, you know, because the first story was a little bit different, you know, the first draft. Then after this, I started to put different things of my life into the script, like the village in Mallorca, because he's from Madrid, you know, the scriptwriter. He didn't live in this village, you know. But I think we thought that was a universal story. This can be a village from Mallorca, but can be a village from, you know, other place in the world. And then I decided, you know, to move the story to Mallorca, to my village, and there is a little, you know, very little autobiographic notes around this script, you know. But the first story, the first idea was from Arturo. That is a great screenwriter. No, they are new actors, the girl and the boy. The girl just made one film when she was, I think, 12 years old. And the boy is his first feature film.
He did a great job.
I did the casting and I found them, and they are great, and great persons.
Expensive too?
No.
Nothing about this film was expensive, believe me. Right, Tony?
Right.
Carl, maybe you could talk a little bit about working with the two young actors?
Yeah, well, as Tony said, Biel character, he's actually from Mallorca and was very familiar with it, but Celia came from Madrid. She's from Madrid, yeah. And so that they kind of like, she had television experience and that, but Biel had, it was his first job, I think. Period, yeah. But they're both, you know, two like, as you say, they were great performances, and they're two instinctive actors. And it was very interesting for me because some of the other actors as well, Vicky Peña, who plays his mother, Biel's mother, is a very famous actress in Spain. She's, you know, she's one of the great Spanish cinema actresses. And with her and with the kids, it really taught me a lesson that actors respond to each other instinctively. You don't need language necessarily sometimes. It's looks and feelings and they communicate themselves without necessarily language. And that was very much the case with the two kids. They were just a pleasure, a joy to work with, and you know, open and interested, and the performances showed that, I think.
It was very, very interesting process with Colm, because most part of the crew, the actors, spoke Spanish, and he didn't understand Spanish, and they didn't understand him speaking in English. That was great for the character. Mallorquín is a dialect from Catalan. You know, Balearic Islands are very close from Catalonia, and we you know, most of there are three islands, Ibiza, Mallorca, and Menorca, and the three islands speak, you know, three different dialects from Catalan. You know, this is Mallorquin. And in all the villages in Mallorca, people speak in Mallorquin, but you know, everybody knows Spanish, of course, you know. And in Mallorca, there is now a lot of people living there that come from everywhere. You know, there are people from Germany, people from England, people from other parts of Spain. And there is a lot of cultures, a lot of different languages, you know. It's very easy to find people who speak English, Mallorquin, Spanish, German, you know. And that's what I want to show with the film, you know, this part of the multiculturality, you know.
But it's interesting that point about it. We you know, I thought in Spain they spoke Spanish. And I'm a fool. But when you go to Mallorca, you realize and it's not just Catalonia, you know, like Barcelona and Catalonia are very much, the culture is very strong, very much alive, and there's a great rivalry between Madrid and Barcelona and on every front, sporting, cultural, every front. But then there's the Basque, there's like five different languages in Spain.
Four official languages.
And then like as Tony says, Mallorquin is like a dialect of Catalan. It's not exactly Catalan. So for someone like me, it's very confusing.
Do we have more questions?
Yeah. Hi, I was wondering.
So how did he prepare for the character? Was the question, in case you can.
Yeah. Not really. I mean, I when I read the script, I was fascinated by the idea of playing a character who doesn't speak. And apart from the fact, I don't have to learn any lines here. This is cool. But. I really kind of thought this is. I mean, I love the script, and I watch Tony's short films, which are amazing. If you ever get a chance to see them, which made me want to do it. But there was an added sort of fascination for me. And can I do this? Can I play a character who doesn't actually speak? And the more I thought about it, the more kind of fascinated I was by it. And I didn't do any special preparation in that, because with this script, because it's a well-written script, it's the intentions of the character are very clear. There's not, you don't have to do a lot of figuring out what's going on here, you know? So, but that was very much in my head all the time, that it's to play the reactions, to play the emotions without speaking was just a real challenge, and you know, but I enjoyed it very much.
And did you study what was actually being said to you before you went into the scene, or did you find it more helpful to not?
No, pretty much. I mean, I had an English translation of the script from 2 years before, and every new draft, of which there were many, was I would get an English translation of it, so I knew what this. But I intentionally didn't sort of sit down before we shot the scene and said, what exactly is she saying here? Yeah. I mean, the scenes with Anna Wagner, you know, when she's just gone on and on and on. It was. I found it was better just not to know.
The gentleman here?
Yes, that's part of the reality. Okay, in a different places in Mallorca, in the forest, in the mountain, Mallorca is, you know, there's a lot of caves. You know, it's an island with a lot of caves. There's a famous caves in Mallorca called Cuevas del Drac, that they are very, very touristic caves, you know, and they are beautiful. But the rest of the island, there are a lot of caves. There are this kind of vertical caves. There are a lot of them, and they're really dangerous. If you walk by during the night, walk, you need a flashlight, because they are really dangerous. There are a lot of people who get lost, you know, lost around the forest. In my village, 20 years ago, there was an old man that go take a walk to the forest, and he disappeared. And we start searching for him during 20 days, 30 days, and disappeared. And the people from my village said, this guy is inside, he felt in a pothole, you know, and it's very difficult to find him, you know, because that kind of pothole, there are 90 meters, sometimes 100 meters in vertical. If you fall in, kaput. That's true, yeah. Oh, it was very special. you want to explain?
Sure.
It?
I had been spending time in Mallorca since about 02 or 03, and about 07 or something. Tony had been working on the script, and he'd been working with a different production company who ended up not making the film. But he was talking to them one day, and they were just sitting around, like, what, making plans about the project. And Tony said the actor he wanted to play this part was me. And they said, well, and he said, like, do you know him? And they said, he has a house in Sawyer. It's just, you know, it's 10 miles up the road. And Tony was like, I couldn't believe it. But we're actually neighbours. He comes from Buñola, his village. And I was living in a village called Sawyer. And it's connected, we're the other side of the mountain, but it's connected by a tunnel. It's about, like, it's a 7-minute drive, you know? And, but he didn't know I was there. He says, I keep a very low profile. When Tony found this out, he said, well, can we talk to him? And they called me, and Tony and I met, and he gave me the script, and I read the script and loved it. And then I watched his short films, and for which Tony has won a number of Goyas, the Spanish academies. And I thought this is a great project. I'd love to be involved. But then we had to start the process of trying to raise the money and make the film, which took us another 2.5 years.
Right here?
Many.
Did they consider any other Indians?
Many, yeah.
Don't go there again. Oh, no.
Of course. No. It was a really difficult decision to kill him. Yeah, because, you know, most of the film is a comedy. Yeah. And I know that the last 20 minutes are really dramatic, but you know what? Our life is like this, you know. Someday there is a comedy, and the next day it's a drama, you know. And we thought, Arturo and me, the scriptwriter and me, thought that the best was to finish his story inside, where it all began. You know, his story, the story that we see at the film, began with Grace. You know, the girlfriend, his wife. You know, that she fell into one of these dangerous holes, you know. And we thought that the best was to conclude, you know, the story of Mark in the same place, you know. But at the end, we leave, you know, an open, you know, open,
a little opening.
I know that some people thought when they saw the film, that what happened? He's alive, he's dead. Okay. It's in your mind now, you know, what you prefer. In my mind is, he's dead. Yeah. I'm just really sorry. But he's dead.
In my mind is not. No, we did. We went back and forth about this many times, and as with everything else in the script, as I said, there were many, many drafts. And I think Tony's absolutely, I mean, the conclusion, the final conclusion was that my wife had died at the beginning, and this is what set the whole process into motion. It was very good to conclude with him in a similar situation. So I think it makes a very nice dramatic sense.
Have any future projects together?
Yes, I
ever again.
Of course. No, I'm now. You know, I'm living now this moment. You know, this incredible moment with the film. Now the premiere in Spain is on March. Now there's not released in Spain. We start the 23rd of March there. We will see what happens. And after this, we are preparing different scripts and different projects. I don't know what happened. One of them, I think, Colombia is the best situated. So it's the best. I don't expression. Sorry.
Choice.
Yes.
That's a
best choice for one of the projects, yes.
I have to say, if you haven't seen
it.
Any last questions? Yep, lady right here.
Was the young policeman, is he a professional actor, or was he from the village?
Who was him?
The young policeman.
No, they are professional actors. Yeah, both of them. One is from Madrid and she's known in TV series. And the other is my, there is a word in Spanish called fetiche actor. It's like the actor that worked with me in the shorts. And it's his first, it's Vidal, you know, the bad guy. He worked with me in the shorts and this is his first feature film.
What about the good guy? What's his name?
Okay, the name.
Good guy.
The good guy, yeah. Carlos. Carlos. Yeah.
No, they were two wonderful, wonderful double act. They're just two great actors doing great performance there.
Okay, last question, this lady right here.
Where can we access your short films? Did they mention twice? How can we...
The short films? By internet, I think now is the best. The best. Yeah. They're on the internet.
Is there a website that they can go to?
Yeah, there's one website. But I think it's without English subtitles. But at the net, you know, in Vimeo or YouTube, I think you can find most of them.
Mm-hmm. So lady there at the back, desperate.
Lady at the back.
The question is that she loves the film and yeah, thank you and say congratulations to. And the question is if the film will come to United States, you know. By now we don't have distribution. Yeah. We are looking for distribution and maybe, I don't know. I wish, you know, I know that it's difficult for foreigner films, you know, to have a commercial release, you know. But I know that there are some cinemas that are interested in foreigner films and okay, by now we don't have distribution. Okay, this is the second screening, you know, maybe after this we will find it.
Well, I think everyone certainly hopes.
Felicitaciones, Miguel, el perfecto desconocido. Cuéntame cómo ha sido la producción de esta película, en primer lugar tener una estrella como Colm. ¿Cómo lo has logrado? ¿Cómo lo has trabajado? ¿Qué retos has tenido?
Mira, realmente el poder contar con Colm es un trabajo previo de Tony, el director Tony Bestard, que llevaba moviendo este proyecto unos 5 años atrás. Realmente al principio la primera productora que fue a ver fue la mía, la Singular. Pero yo le dije que no estábamos preparados ni en el momento de producir la película. Y una serie de años después vino, otra vez con el proyecto ya más maduro, con el guión más avanzado y ya con el contacto de Colm. Y a partir de ahí, en un año, conseguimos levantar la financiación y rodar la película.
¿Cuánto costó hacer el proyecto?
El presupuesto de la película es 1.131.500 euros. Esto en dólares estará por debajo del $1.5 million de dólares.
¿Y ha sido financiada con algún tipo de apoyo del Estado también?
Sí, del Ministerio de Cultura. Ya. Después hay dos televisiones autonómicas de España que han entrado. Una en coproducción y con compra de derechos, que es la televisión de Baleares, IB3, y otra con compra de derechos, que es la televisión de Cataluña, TV3.
¿Cómo es el reto para ti como productor en España? ¿Cómo está tu trabajo, tu labor? Yo sé que son tiempos difíciles para tu país, pero...
Es difícil. Esta es la primera película de Singular, la productora. El primer largometraje.
Excelente. Y a la vez el primero de Tony. O sea que todos han estado estrenándose.
Eso es. Era la primera vez para mucha gente. Pero me lo puse como un reto porque queríamos dar un paso hacia la calidad, hacia el producto audiovisual de calidad, básicamente, y marcarnos un reto profesional. Yo creo que lo hemos sacado, gracias también a la presencia de Colm, estrella internacional, y también al buen hacer de Tony y de todo el equipo que lo ha rodeado.
¿Qué sigue ahora? ¿Cómo es la distribución en España para el cine español? ¿Cómo va a funcionar esto?
Ahora en España vamos a estrenar el 23 de marzo. Vamos a salir al principio con poquitas copias, seleccionando muy bien los cines donde exhibir para ir claramente al público que nos interesa. Y a partir de ahí veremos si la película crece con la respuesta del público, con el boca a boca, ¿no? A nivel internacional todavía no se ha cerrado ninguna venta para salas de cine, pero es que siempre se espera normalmente a que una película se estrene en el país propio para tener feedback de cómo responde y luego aprovechar los contactos que han hecho en festivales para terminar las ventas con otros países.
Perdón, ¿es este el primer festival en el que participa?
No, el primer festival en el que estuvo la película fue el de Busan, en Corea del Sur. Festival muy grande con un mercado asiático, un mercado que cubre la parte asiática, muy grande y muy relevante en la zona asiática. Después estuvo en un festival de España, que es el de Valladolid, conocido como la Seminci. Y ahora estamos aquí, en Palm Springs, y esperemos estar en otros.
¿Y es el estreno en Estados Unidos? ¿Y por qué Palm Springs?
Bueno, primero todo porque Palm Springs nos escogió, entonces encantados de estar aquí. Y después porque yo creo que en Palm Springs es un festival que está muy abierto a lo latino, a las influencias de otros países, donde tienen ganas de recibir inputs, de recibir películas de muchos sitios diversos, con historias humanas también, que vayan más allá del cine puramente comercial estadounidense.
¿Existe algún tipo de estrategia dentro de los circuitos de festivales que están siguiendo para esta película? ¿O todavía están un poquito viendo...?
Pues eso, que estamos encantados de la respuesta del público. Los dos pases han ido muy bien. La gente ha respondido durante la proyección a todos los elementos de comedia y dramáticos que había. Estamos muy sorprendidos porque veníamos con dudas. A ver el público estadounidense, ¿cómo va a coger la película? ¿Va a captar lo que está ahí dentro, lo que nosotros queremos que está ahí dentro? Pues ha sido así y encantados.
No, sí, yo pienso que definitivamente el mensaje llega, se entiende, muy bien, cumple su cometido. ¿Y ahora qué sigue para ustedes? ¿Tienes planeado seguir trabajando con Tony, sí, con Colm? ¿Se han hecho? Sí. Porque siempre que comienza algo se genera toda una química y de ahí eso pues es. Cuéntame es. Qué es lo que está pasando
entre
ustedes.
Ahora en los ratos que tenemos en el hotel, de traslados y demás, estamos hablando constantemente de proyectos. Hay dos sobre la mesa, uno que tiene un tratamiento de guión ya bastante avanzado y otro que está más en la fase de idea. Hemos pensado en ir desarrollando los dos en paralelo, ir buscando financiación y moverlos, porque el equipo ha funcionado, nos encontramos cómodos, Tony y Colm son buenos amigos, y también tengo muy buena relación con los dos y apetece seguir estirando de ese hilo.
Y yo creo que ya él como que picó al público hispano y definitivamente al público español del país de ustedes. Yo creo que van a quedarse con ganas de seguir viendo un poco más a Colm ahí en películas españolas. Y el hecho de que, bueno, ya no es low profile, ahora todo el mundo sabe que vive en España.
Sí, Colm, de hecho, disfrutó mucho el hecho de ir del rodaje a casa en coche en un cuarto de hora, 20 minutos. Creo que es la primera vez que ha podido hacerlo en su vida. Claro, una estrella internacional está todo el día viajando arriba, abajo, diferentes localizaciones, diferentes festivales, y eso lo disfrutó mucho. Yo me acuerdo cómo a veces venía incluso su hija y en el rodaje a recogerlo con su madre. Muy bien, o sea, en Mallorca es un sitio amable para vivir y también para rodar. Yo creo que se ha quedado con ganas de hacer otra.
Me parece muy bien. Bueno, muchas gracias por la entrevista. ¿Y algo más que quieras agregar, Miguel?
No, a darte las gracias a ti por tu amabilidad y por tu atención.
Gracias.